Today I am going to continue from where we left yesterday. Yesterday the entire discussion was on research methods, and before that I did discuss few things, very basic things about research. Why do we do research? How do we select a topic? What are the criteria of selecting or thinking about a good topic? So we had detailed discussions on that, not discussion as such, because this platform doesn't allow you to have too much of discussion. So I actually briefed you about what should be the criteria of when you're thinking about your research topic, when you're thinking about your research question. So today, this is in continuation with what we discussed yesterday. So today I'm generally going to discuss about how should you select your research method, research tool, research method, research design, whatever you may call. So what are the criteria? What could be the criteria? What could be the parameters of selecting your research design? So like yesterday, I would try to share a PPT with you. So just give me 30 seconds to share the PPT. Yes. Yes. So you can see the title of today's presentation is Selecting an Appropriate Research Method. And there would be a lot of focus on survey method. When should we select survey as a research tool? And when somebody selects survey as a research tool, what are the criteria, what are the elements, what are the caution, how one should proceed using survey method. So just have a look at this chart. These are various stages of research when somebody does research in social sciences, whether you are in a university or in a research institute. So this is the flow chart of doing research, doing your MPhil, doing your PhD. First, we define a research problem. This is after you have decided about your research topic, then we define a research problem. We could also say research question. This we discussed yesterday. Review of concepts and theories. So this is literature review. Reviewing concepts and theories, review previous research findings. So these are the two stages. The first, think of a research topic, think of a research question. Once you have finalized your research question, you do review of literature. There was a participant yesterday who did ask this question: is it all right to do review of literature even before you finalize your research question or research topic? That would be wonderful to do. But even if you do review of literature even after you have finalized your research question, that's all right. And then you formulate hypothesis. And formulating hypothesis after review of literature is more useful, because by this time you are acquainted with whatever work has been done on that topic. So you are better placed, a researcher is better placed to formulate hypothesis. So you formulate hypothesis. So these stages we had discussed yesterday. And today we are at the stage which is in blue color, research design, how to select a research design. We had a discussion yesterday about various research design. Just to recap, broadly we divide all the research design into two types: qualitative research and quantitative research. I flagged off various research design within the qualitative research. Also within quantitative research, the use of secondary data and the use of primary data. And if a researcher want to collect primary data for his or her research, then he would need to do a survey. He would need to use survey as a research method. So the discussion about various research method was held yesterday. I discussed about 7 various types of qualitative research and broadly 2 kinds of quantitative research. One in which a researcher uses secondary data from various sources. I flagged off the sources: census, NSHO, and NSSO, then NFHS, and there are various other sources from where a researcher can use the secondary data if the researcher want to apply a quantitative method of research. Researcher can also do a survey in order to collect primary data. If researcher want to apply quantitative method of research. Now the question is, which method is best method of doing research? If this is a question which is posed, which is the best method, which is the best research design, which is the best method to do research? To give you an answer up front, there is nothing called best research design. Every research design has strength and weakness. There are merits and demerits. But one should not select the research design keeping in mind if a research design has more strength and less weaknesses, or more weaknesses, less strength. A researcher needs to think carefully about research question, the topic on which you want to do research. And then one has to figure out which research design would suit best for your kind of research, the topic on which you want to do research. So remember, the point I'm trying to stress is that there are various research methods, there are various research design within the 2 broad classification of research design: qualitative method and quantitative method. There is no hierarchy. There is no way to figure out which research design is better than the other one. There is no way to figure out which is the best research design and which is the worst research design. It depends upon every research method has strength, weakness. There cannot be any agreement about which research design is best. Research design normally complements each other. But as a researcher, how you should think of selecting research design, that should be guided by your own requirement, the topic on which you want to do the research. You have to think carefully. Which research design would suit your requirement, which would suit the requirement of your data collection on the topic on which you want to do research. The problem I see across many universities in India is that research design is selected without giving any careful thought. Research design is selected largely by your own likes and dislikes. If you think you are fascinated about survey, you blindly want to pick up survey as your research design. If you hate survey, and this is kind of a division in social science academia in India, I can tell you based on my interaction with researchers across the country. Sharp division. I don't like quantitative method. I like qualitative method. And then you would meet across researcher who would say, I like quantitative method. I like to do survey. I don't like qualitative method. Likes and dislikes is all right. You have every right as a researcher, you have every right to like a research method. But your like and dislike should not be the criteria for selecting your research design. Your the criteria for selecting research design is guided by your research question, the kind of data which is required to analyze your research question, and which method may be more appropriate for collecting the data which is required for your own research question. That should be the guiding principle for selecting research design, not your likes and dislikes. Many researchers in India face this problem of selecting a wrong research design, and they end up landing themselves in a great difficulty. And I will give you some example to explain that research designs are selected without giving any careful thought. And once you select your research design, you are already halfway through collecting the data, and later on you realize that you are finding it extremely, extremely difficult to collect the data. But what do you do? You might say, I will junk this research design, pick up another research design. Yes, you could do that, but by the time you would have, you know, wasted your time, energy, money, and a three-year PhD, which normally goes on to say 5 years, 6 years, you may end up doing your PhD in say 7 years. So you have already wasted 2 or 3 years of your academic career. So selecting a wrong research design, which is the case with many researchers across the country, at least when I'm saying this, I'm saying based on my own experience. When I discuss research question and research design with various scholars, many research scholars end up selecting a wrong research design. And that happens only because many researchers select research design based on their own likes and dislikes without giving any careful thought which research design is more suited for the kind of question on which he or she wants to do research. So now I will pose some questions. Just one second. I will just pose. Just a second. It's again the PPT is not working. Just 1 minute. Yes. So, how to select the research method? And I'm posing a question. I will also try and give responses to that. Can any research method be applied to any kind of topic on which you want to do research? So, this is a question. I'm trying to pose, asking you to think for a minute. Can any research method be applied to any kind of topic on which you want to do research? Or is there some limitation while selecting research method? The answer is very clear and very straight from my side. No, or any kind of research method cannot be applied on any topic. Topic is very important to guide your research, selection of your research method. So one has to think carefully about the topic. The topic of your study, your research question, kind of data you need for your research, to analyze your research question. And based on those considerations, you have to think about selecting your research method. Again, repeating again and again. And I'm repeating this again and again to stress the point, likes and dislikes for a research method should not be the guiding principle. It is the topic. It is the nature of the requirement of the data and the process through which a researcher can collect the data. And that guides your selection of research method. Is there some limitation while selecting research method? Yes, there are limitations. There are topics on which a particular research method may not be applicable. It cannot be answered in just yes and no, but it is also a question of being more appropriate, a research method being more appropriate compared to other research method. we cannot say that this research method cannot be applied. In some cases, that may be the case. But largely, it is about appropriateness, whether a research method is more appropriate compared to the other research method. Now the question is, which research method should be selected for conducting research? Qualitative method or quantitative method? How should one select research tool? Again, this is kind of a repeating, that which method should be selected? Whether researcher should select a qualitative method or a quantitative method? I know by this time, for the last 10-15 minutes, I have been trying to explain this. And by this time, it must be clear to you that it is very difficult to give an answer to this question, or I would say one cannot give an answer to this question, that which research method should be selected by the researcher for doing research, whether researcher should select a qualitative method or researcher should select a quantitative method. The answer is, we don't know whether researcher should be selecting a qualitative method or a quantitative method without knowing the topic of researcher's research. So blindly, one cannot say that a researcher must select a quantitative method or a researcher should select a qualitative method. The answer to this question can only be given once we know what is the topic on which researcher want to do research. Without knowing that, one cannot give an answer whether a researcher should select a qualitative method or a quantitative method. If you as a researcher ask me this question, whether I should select quantitative method or a qualitative method, my immediate counter question would be, please tell me the topic on which you want to do research, and then I need to think carefully what kind of data researcher would require for the kind of question on which researcher want to do research, and what could be the best way to collect this data. And then I can tell you, I may be able to guide you about whether the researcher should go for a qualitative method or a quantitative method. We had some questions from some scholars yesterday. Can somebody use a mixed method? You could also use mixed method. But all these decisions can be taken only after we come to know what is the topic on which researcher is doing research. This question is based on some of the questions which were raised yesterday by the researcher. Is there a strict division between area, subject, stream of research and research method? Or is selection of research method guided by topic? No, there is no strict division. People doing research in economics, there is no division that people, if somebody is doing research in economics, that person should be using quantitative method and no other method. Or if somebody is doing research in, say, history, the person should be using one specific research method and not the other one. No strict division. There is no strict division between stream of research and research method. This should be very, very clear to you, that there is no specification that people doing research in political science should be using qualitative method or quantitative method. People doing research in psychology must be using one particular kind of research method. Or is the selection of research method by topic? So the research method, the selection of research method should be guided by the topic. There is no strict division of stream and research method. Nature of data and research method. This is the criteria. This is the guiding principle for any researcher before he or she thinks about which research method should he or she be using. As I said, you have a research question and you need data to answer the research question. And then the researcher carefully looks at the nature of the data. What kind of data would be required to answer the research question? And once you look at the nature of data which may be required for answering the research question. And then researcher needs to think carefully that if the nature of data is of this kind, what could be the best way to collect this data? So the nature of data, the process through which the data could be collected, actually guides you in selecting your research method. So that, remember two things: your research question, and as you know, as a researcher, you need to collect data to analyze your research question, to explain your research question. So research question, data, and research method. These three things are connected, and the selection of research method is guided largely by your research question and the nature of data which is required for answering your research question or testing your hypothesis. So that is the guiding principle of selecting a research method, nothing else. Absolutely no to your likes and dislikes. You may not like survey method, you may not like to do ethnography, you may not like to do a case study method, but if you have selected a topic which requires the researcher to do an ethnography, there is no escape from that. You cannot do a survey if your research topic required someone to do an ethnography. So there, it can't be a substitute. Again, a recap of what we discussed yesterday also, basic difference between quantitative and qualitative research. These are two broad divisions of research method. Quantitative research is employed for measuring the quantity or amount of a particular phenomena by use of statistical analysis. And a qualitative research is a non-quantitative type of analysis which is aimed at finding out the quality of a particular phenomena. So these are two basic divisions in the research method, quantitative research and a qualitative research method. So the broad principle of selection of either you want to do a quantitative research or a qualitative research is guided by, as I said, you need to look at your research question. You also need to look at the kind of data you require to answer your research question. And you also need to think what could be the best way to select the data which you require for answering your research question. There is an additional point. You also need to think about the research output, whether you want to come up with the findings of your research question in numbers, in quantity. If you want to come out with the findings of your research questions in quantity, then you have to select a quantitative method. If you don't intend to come out with the findings of your research in quantitative way, you want to come up with the findings of your research question in a qualitative manner, then you need to select a qualitative research method. There are various qualitative research methods which we discussed yesterday. So these are the guiding principles of whether a researcher should select quantitative research method or one of the qualitative research method, or researcher can even think of using a mixed method of data collection in order to do research. So these are the guiding principles, basic broad principles of selecting research method. Unless and until I know your research question, I won't be able to tell you whether you should select a quantitative method or a qualitative method. So in order to explain how researcher should think of selecting a quantitative method or a qualitative method, I need to give some examples of some research questions. These are not very fine-tuned research questions. These research questions are just for explaining things, taking practical examples. So I'm going to move ahead, posing some research questions, and then trying to give you an idea if the research questions are of this kind, what kind of a method may be more suitable, and what kind of answers the different kinds of method can bring about to these research questions. As I said yesterday also, since lot of my research is on voting behavior, many of my examples are from voting behavior study, behavioral study, election studies. So if I take up three research questions, as I said, these are not very carefully designed research questions. These are just questions to explain. With these questions, I will be able to explain better how one should select a research design. So first, how did Muslims in UP voted during the 2017 assembly elections? Remember yesterday also I said all research questions must end with a question mark. How did Muslims of UP voted during 2019 Lok Sabha elections? And has there been some shift in the pattern of Muslims, voting pattern of Muslims in UP during last few years? If these are the research questions, now the choice, now researcher is facing this choice, and these are hypothetical research questions. So suppose these are the questions a researcher has picked up. Has there been a shift in pattern of Muslim voting pattern of Muslims during last few years? Now researcher has to think about which method he or she should select for doing research. As I said, three things should guide selection of research method. This is the research question. One is research question. So the research question is in front of you. Then you have an hypothesis. You now need to figure out what kind of data do you require for analyzing, is there a shift in voting pattern of Muslims during last few years? And also researcher needs to be clear in his mind whether the findings of this kind of a research question he or she want to come out in numbers or in textual forms. If a researcher want to come out, because a quantitative method will give the researcher output, the research output in numbers. It is always about quantity, it is always about numbers. And the qualitative method of research will never give the research output, answer to these research questions in numbers. So researcher needs to have some clarity in his mind whether researcher want to analyze these research questions. If a researcher has picked up one of these research questions, whether he want to give answer, he want to search answers for these questions by doing research after collecting data, and whether the researcher is interested in coming out with the findings of these research questions in terms of numbers or in terms of, you know, description. Like you could say, oh, today is your birthday, so and the research and the question could be, so suppose today is somebody's birthday, so one could say, okay, he has reached, you know, 45 years of age. And the other person can also explain this phenomena by saying he is growing older and older. Just a crude example to suggest the question of these are two different ways of answering one phenomena. One is by in numbers, that somebody has turned 45 today. Today is his or her birthday. And the same phenomena is being explained by someone as saying he is growing older. So if the researcher is interested in coming out answers to these research question, answer to the research question in numbers, then researcher needs to select a quantitative method of research. And if the researcher is not interested in coming out with the findings in numbers, but in textual form, in description, thick description, then researcher is not required. Then researcher should not think of selecting a quantitative method. Then researcher can select a qualitative method of research in order to do research on these questions. So just trying to explain how. So for the three research questions which I took as an example, these are examples which I am taking. So if somebody has taken, used, if somebody picks up a qualitative method of research for the three questions which I took as example, the question, the answer to those research question could come up in the form of yes, no, many, some, sure. This would be substantiated by some statement, quotes, etc. Remember, the point I am trying to make is that if a researcher has used a qualitative method of research for doing research on whether there is a shift of Muslim vote in favor of BJP in UP, the qualitative method of research would bring answers, would come up with answers not in numbers, never in numbers, but in thick description. These are just very crude examples of description. Yes, no, many. Yes, this is the reason they have got in, and it says this would be substantiated by some statements, quotations, etc. So this is the qualitative method of research, and thick descriptions, quote, statement could be in the form of coming up with explanations why there is shift of, you know, Muslims in favor of BJP, or why there has been no shift of Muslims in favor of BJP if a qualitative method has been used. And if the quantitative method has been used by the researcher to explain the research question, is there a shift of Muslim vote in favor of BJP in UP during last couple of years? A quantitative method would always give answer to this question in numbers. It will help in quantifying the finding and never in, you know, yes, no, quotations, etc., etc. Thick description will not be there. So the point I am trying to make is researcher also needs to have clarity in his or her mind whether he or she is interested in coming up with research findings in numbers, in exact numbers, or researcher is interested only in, not in numbers, but in thick descriptions. So that this clarity in the mind of researcher well in advance is also the guiding principle. The guiding is also helps the researcher in thinking about whether he or she should select qualitative method or quantitative method. When should researcher, when it may be useful to use quantitative method or survey as a research tool? When the universe of study is very large, numerically, geographically, as well as diverse. The point I am trying to make is for this research question, like whether Muslims, is there a shift in the Muslim voting in UP during last few years? So for these, this kind of a research, as I said, for this research, the researcher can use either a qualitative method or a quantitative method. The researcher, it is possible for the researcher to use one of these methods. But for a topic or universe on which a topic on which researcher is trying to do the research is very large, numerically, geographically, and diverse. In such situation, survey research or quantitative method is more appropriate. It is also about a method being more appropriate compared to other method. This is what I stated at the beginning. It will not be easy. It is not easy to say this method is the best method and the other method is the worst method. It is all, or this method cannot be applied. There can be some research topic on which we can say, oh, this method is almost impossible to be applied for doing research. But generally, it is about being more appropriate and being less appropriate. So, survey method should be applied on a topic which is very large, numerically, geographically, as well as diverse. And the example which I gave, Muslims of UP. UP is very large, geographically, numerically, diverse also. Because even if we are talking only about Muslims, Muslims are of not one kind. There is diversity of gender, education, occupation, class, all kinds of diversity. So, in such a situation, survey would be more appropriate compared to using one of the qualitative method. One can also use a qualitative method to answer, to investigate these research questions. I am not saying that other method cannot be used. It can also be used, but it is generally about a method being more appropriate and a method being less appropriate. As I said, if a qualitative method is used, then the question, the answer to those question, is there a shift among Muslim vote in favor of BJP? The answers could be, are likely to be in, you know, yes, there is some shift. No, there is no shift. Many women have shifted, not men have shifted. And these would be substantiated by some statement, quotations, etc. But if a quantitative method has been used by the researcher, the findings could be in this form. As I said, quantitative method, the findings will be quantified in numbers. And it will be more or less like this. Generally, I'm just trying to give some examples. Yes, in UP, 60% Muslims voted for Samajwadi Party and Congress. 20% for BSP, 15% for various other smaller parties. 2019 Lok Sabha elections, among the Muslim voters in UP, 80% voted for SP and BSP, 11% for the Congress, and 3% for smaller parties. Between these two elections, there had been some shift among the Muslims in favor of Congress and away from Samajwadi Party. So, a quantitative method of research would give these kind of answers to the research question. It is not that exactly this is going to be like this, but just to give you an example. Again, I would like to stress that, remember, it is about method being more appropriate. Which method is more appropriate for doing research? Researcher has to be very, very careful about that before someone selects a research question. I will try to give you an example of tools being available for various kinds of work and why an appropriate tool needs to be selected before you start doing the work. I can give you an example of, say, for cutting, there are different tools to cut different things. There is a knife which can be used for cutting. There is an axe, kulhadi, which can also be used to cut things. There can be sword to cut different kinds of thing. I can think about three different. There's a nail cutter to cut your nail as well. So you can imagine three, four different tools for cutting. Like you have different methods of doing research, methods of collecting data. So there's a knife, there is an axe, there is a nail cutter, and there is also a sword. Now you have to cut a tree, you have to cut your nail, you also have to cut vegetables. Now all the three or the four tools are lying on your table, and in order to cut the vegetables and the fruit, you will be very, very careful. You know which tool to select. If you have to cut your nails, you know which tool to select. And if you have to cut a tree, you know which tool to select. But imagine what would happen if somebody wanted to cut a tree and he picks up a knife to cut a big tree, which is a 50-year-old tree, a very big tree in the garden. Or imagine what would happen if somebody wanted to cut apples and vegetables and he picks up a nail cutter, or he picks up a axe or a sword to cut the vegetables. You can imagine what would happen. The person may not be able to cut the vegetables properly. He may end up cutting his hand, his finger. And if you want to cut your nails with a knife, you can try doing that. I'm not saying you should do that, but if you try doing that, you know what will happen. You will not be able to cut your nails properly. You may end up cutting your finger. So what is the example which I am trying to give is that there are tools available for cutting different kinds of objects, different kinds of things. And we are very careful in selecting these tools when we want to use these tools for cutting different kinds of things. Similarly, there are different methods available for doing research, different methods available for collecting data. We have to be very, very careful in selecting these research methods. One of these research methods, or a collection or a pair of these research methods in order to collect data, if we pick up a wrong research tool, the result will be more or less the same as the result would be of trying to cut a tree with a small knife, or trying to cut vegetables and fruits with an axe, or trying to cut your nails with a knife. In a day-to-day life, it becomes very visible. You can see it immediately that what has happened if you try to cut your nails with help of a knife. But in research, in which you spend years, you spend four or five years to do your PhD, you realize very late. And by the time you realize, you have already landed yourself in a trouble. If you needed to do an ethnography, but you end up using survey method to collect your data, and you ended up collecting the data which is not appropriate for your research. It could be vice versa. You needed to do a survey, but you went for a case study method, and you ended up collecting the data which is not appropriate for explaining your research question, and you landed yourself in a trouble. So again, research question, the kind of data you need for explaining your research question, and also imagine well in advance what kind of research output you intend to come up with in your thesis, whether you want to write thick description, you want to explain things more in more details rather than putting research output in numbers. Based on all these three considerations, you should try and select one of the research method or a combination of research method if you want to use multiple methods. So one has to be very, very careful about selecting research method. As I said, and I'm repeating it again and again, and the reason for repeating it again and again is I have seen this happening in many universities among many researchers, that they just don't pay attention about research method and or which research method is more appropriate for the kind of question which the researcher want to investigate, and they pick up the research method blindly. And if you do that, you land yourself in a trouble. You are not able to collect the kind of data you require for your research, and maybe that affects the quality of the research at the end. You may not realize, because you may not be able to compare similar kind of a research done by someone else using a different kind of data, but it does affect the quality of your analysis, affect the quality of your research. Let me take some more examples to explain. If you know, the research is something like, will demonetization help solve the problem of black money in India? What do people think? Has demonetization affected the poor people more or the rich people or equally? And did people face difficulty in withdrawing money from the bank? This is at the time of demonetization. Will demonetization help BJP in making electoral gains from in the forthcoming assembly elections? So if these are, if the research question, if the research is on demonetization and its impact on the lives of the people, has demonetization affected the economic and the social life of the people? Question mark. Hypothesis, yes, demonetization has resulted in great difficulty to the people. So this is the hypothesis. Now I have to figure out whether I want to collect, whether I want to come up with answers to these questions in a quantitative manner. Do I want to quantify answers to these research questions, or do I want thick descriptions? Once I am clear about the output, once I anticipate the output, because the research question is in front of me, hypothesis is in front of me, and once I know, once I anticipate, once I imagine what kind of research output I intend to come up with, then I should figure out whether the research, whether the tool I should be selecting is, should be a quantitative method or a qualitative method. So this should be the guiding principle of selecting the research method. So just to flag, how would be the output if somebody has selected a qualitative method using for this question, research question, and what could be the output for similar research question using a quantitative method? For a qualitative method, it could be generally like public are generally in support of demonetization, problem of black money has been solved to a great extent, some extent, and the researcher might also come up with the explanation why it has been able to, why this has been, why problem of the black money has been solved. It has affected the rich people more than the, you know, the poor people. Few people had problem, not many, about depositing the money. Public will vote more for BJP in forthcoming election as public are in support of this policy. So generally trying to give you an idea about this would be kind of the form of research output using a qualitative method. While I'm, these are, again I'm saying, this is just a crude example. Don't think that this is the only output. It would be substantiated by lots and lots of thick description. But if somebody has used a quantitative method, the data would come like this. Demonetization was a right move. Punjab, Uttar Pradesh, in Jharkhand, different proportion of people. So the answers have now been quantified for the three states. So this will be the kind of a output based on a quantitative method. I'm not trying to go into the details of these, so, but just trying to stress the point that if a researcher is clear in his mind that he would like to come up with the findings in numbers, he would like to quantify, then a researcher needs to use a quantitative method, and this is the kind of research output which would come up using a quantitative method. Faced a lot of problem in depositing money. Punjab, 60% people said they had a lot of difficulty. In Uttarakhand, it was 23%, etc., etc. I can skip another example and then move on to quantitative method. Now, is it necessary to conduct a survey if somebody selects a quantitative method of research for a topic on which he or she want to do research? If yes, why? If no, then how does one conduct research using a quantitative method without survey? I spent some time explaining this yesterday, that if somebody want to do a quantitative method, if a researcher is using a quantitative method for his research, is it necessary for the researcher to do a survey, or can a researcher use a quantitative method without doing a survey? Yes, a researcher can use a quantitative method and can do away without a survey. Researcher can use secondary data for explaining the research question, his or her research question, or if the survey would be required only and only if the researcher want to collect primary data for his or her own research. So a quantitative method can be used. Remember, I did say a survey method is more appropriate for as a research method if the research on, or if the topic on which researcher is doing the research is very wide, is very large, both numerically, geographically, and even diverse, then survey becomes a very important tool, very effective tool of doing research. Now the question is, if somebody is doing, is somebody wants to use a quantitative method, is it necessary for the researcher to do a survey, or can a researcher use a quantitative method without doing the survey? Yes, a researcher can use a quantitative method and not do a survey. Researcher can use a secondary data. I did mention yesterday, there are various sources of secondary data, but it is important that the secondary data should be available on the topic on which researcher want to do research. There are various sources of secondary data. If the data is available on the topic or the related topic on which researcher is doing the study, the researcher can use the secondary data, do the analysis, and should be able to finish his research without even doing the survey. But if the research, if the data is not available and the researcher want to use a quantitative data for quantitative method for doing research, then researcher would need to do a survey in order to collect primary data. This is again kind of a repetition, just to stress the point. Remember, I am not saying that survey is the only method, quantitative method is the only method of doing research. One could use any method of doing research. One could do an ethnography method, a case study method, focus group method, or even some other method. If somebody also want to even do a voting behavior study, voting patterns, the kind of study which I have been doing at CSDS, but I always use a survey method. But even for a topic like voting pattern, one could study voting pattern without doing a survey. One could use ethnography, focus group, case study method, etc., etc. It is only about a method being more appropriate and a method being less appropriate. So this is all about how a researcher should think of selecting a research method. As I said, it would be very difficult to explain who should select a qualitative method and who should select a quantitative method, or within a qualitative method, should a researcher select an ethnography method or a case study method or a content analysis method or a focus group method. Without, it would be very difficult to say well in advance. It would be very difficult to forecast if a researcher, hypothetical name Ramesh Kumar, is doing a research in, say, Meerut University, whether he or she should be selecting a case study method or ethnography. The answer can only be given once we know what is the topic on which the person, the researcher, is trying to do the research. So beyond this, it cannot be explained in such an online class that Now, how should you select, how should one select a research method? There has to be a connection between the research topic, the kind of data you need to collect, and the kind of output you envisage in your thesis, whether you want to come up with the research output in numbers. If you want to come up with research output in numbers, you have to do a research, you have to select a quantitative method. If you don't want to come up with research output in number, you can do away with a quantitative method and you can select one of the qualitative methods. But as I said, I would now try to focus a little bit on what is survey method and what are the caution, or how one should, if somebody is doing a survey method, if somebody has selected a survey method within quantitative method, what should be the caution, how one should go about using survey method for doing research. So just to define survey first, what is a survey? It is a technique, a system of collection of information from smaller number of people, which is referred as sample, which helps to describe, compare, or explain the attitude and behavior of larger population. Remember, the stress is on the information is collected from smaller number of people, and this smaller number of people is referred as the sample, which helps to explain and compare the attitude behavior of larger population. One needs to understand that in the survey, if somebody is using a survey method to collect data for a research, the person is doing in a village or in a district or even in a state, it is not required that the person should be collecting data from the every person in the village in which the researcher is doing the study. The technique suggests the researcher should select data from small number of people. And with this small number of people, the researcher should try and explain the attitude and behavior of larger population. People generally tend to criticize survey method, and people would say, oh, but you collected data from only a small number of people. I would explain what this small number of people mean, how small, whether it is 50, 100, or even 10 people, should researcher select information from larger number of people. But it is not required that the data should be collected from each and every one of the universe of which the researcher is trying to do the study. So the method suggests information, data is collected from smaller number of people, which is referred as sample, and from that sample the researcher tries to explain attitude, behavior of larger population, and that larger population is the area of study of the researcher, that is referred as the universe on which researcher is trying to do the study. Various kinds of survey methods: cross-section survey, you just collect the data from, you know, from people and do one-time analysis, that is cross-section survey. Then there is something called longitudinal survey. If you want to do the survey, if you want to collect data and analyze the findings over a period of time to monitor the changes, is there some change in opinion, attitude, behavior of the people over a period of time, then that is called a longitudinal survey. And this over a period of time, there is no specific time limit. It could be every month, it could be 6 months, it could be a year, it could be every 5 years. And within longitudinal survey, there could be three kinds of survey: trend study, cohort study, and a panel design. There are slight differences between the trend study and the cohort study. And what is the trend study? Change universe, change sample. So the universe changes and the sample also changes. The example could be, if I want to know the opinion of the people about demonetization. So I have done a study in urban India. So cross section would be, I did the study in various cities and come up with a finding. Trend study, universe changes and the sample changes. So I did the study once in Bombay, came up with the study that this is the opinion of the people of urban India about demonetization. 5 months after that, I did the study in Delhi and came up with another findings and compared that opinion of the people has changed or not changed. So this is trend study, that there is a change in universe, because now last time the universe was Bombay and this time the universe is Delhi, and there is also the change in the sample. There is something called cohort study, same universe but different kinds of sample. And the example could be, I collected the data in Bombay in the month of January, did the analysis. Again in the month of June, after 6 months, I collected the data again in the city of Bombay, but with among different set of people. So that is a cohort study, and did the comparison. Panel study is same sample, same universe. Naturally, if the sample is the same, the universe will also be the same. So that is a panel design, that I selected a set of people, collected data in the month of January. Again, in the month of June, I wanted to see whether people's opinion have changed or not over a period of time. Same set of people, I collected the data again in the month of June to figure out whether the opinion of the people have changed or not. So that is a panel design. So various kinds of survey methods. Now, strength and weakness of, as I said, every method has strength, every method has weaknesses. No method is foolproof. So what is the criticism of generally the qualitative method, and I picked up say ethnographic study. So generalization based on ethnography, and as I said earlier also yesterday, ethnography is largely done in one or two locations. There is no point in doing ethnography in 10 villages. Ethnographer spend a lot of time only at one location, whether that location is a village or urban location, collect in-depth data. So normally generalization based on ethnography study may not be appropriate, because maybe the village where the data was collected, was ethnography was done, was not a representative. So if you do a study in a village in UP and then generalize the opinion which you get from your study in that village, ethnography, and you try and generalize about people living in the entire UP. So that is kind of a limitation of ethnographic study. I think generalization may not be appropriate. I'm not saying it is wrong or incorrect or correct. Generalization may not be appropriate for a larger universe, and UP would be an example of a larger universe. Just doing a study in just one village or one district and generalizing about the entire UP may not be appropriate. But survey method, you can do that from a survey method. But survey method is also criticized. That limitation is that people say, we are not sure what kind of people, who were the people from whom the data was collected. And the criticism is about whether the right kind of people were selected for the interview, or right, the data was collected from the right kind of people. The question is about sample being representative or sample not being representative. So I will skip these three slides. Now, using survey as a method is very challenging. Every method has challenges. As every method has limitations and strength, there are challenges of using any method. Challenges is about expertise. No method can be applied, used by the researcher without having a knowledge about that method. So every method has challenge. Survey method has these particular challenge. First, the challenge is about say sample size, how many people from how many people you want to collect the data. That's a big challenge. Challenge is diversity of language, multiplicity of caste, religious diversity, different levels of educational attainment, and people from different class background. So the diversity of population poses a big challenge for survey research. And why? Because all these diversities has implications on opinions, attitudes, behavior of the people. Language. In Assam, if you want to know the opinion of the people in Assam, somebody who speaks Bangla and somebody who speaks Assamese and somebody who speaks Hindi, the opinion would be very different on many issues. Multiplicity of caste. We know that in India, there are large number of caste. If you want to collect data on, say, reservation system, if your study is about reservation system in India, policy of reservation, the opinion of the people on this issue would be very, very different, very diverse, very people belonging to different caste. Religious diversity. You talk about any issue, or I can just give the example of the issue of, say, NHRC, or we can pick up any other issue. And the opinion of the people on these issues would be very, very different, very diverse. Educational attainment. People belonging to different levels of educational attainment, educated and uneducated, would have very different views on many subjects. And people belonging to different class background, rich and poor, would have very different opinion on various issues. So if a survey method is being applied by a researcher to collect information on any topic on which he or she is doing the research, these are the challenges one has to face. These are the challenges, but it is not impossible. These are the challenges one has to encounter, but one has to do the survey carefully in order to overcome these challenges. But these are the challenges because these diversities have implications on the opinion, attitudes of the people on different subjects. You can talk about any subject, whether there should be more schools in India or not. If you pick up any subject, there would be differences of opinion among the people because of various kinds of diversities. As I said, there are challenges, but it is not impossible to overcome these challenges. So if somebody, if a researcher is using a survey method for doing survey, for doing research, these are the few things researcher needs to keep in mind. Sample the locations and the people randomly using an appropriate sampling technique. Some of you who may have attended the class yesterday would recall that I did mention yesterday that systematic data collection is essential in research. You cannot collect data haphazardly. And this is one element of systematic data collection. Sample location systematically. Randomly using an appropriate sampling method. There has to be a method, an appropriate method for selecting the locations and the people from whom the data is to be collected. Structured questionnaire. A questionnaire is necessary for collecting data in a survey method. A researcher cannot collect data for his research using a survey method without using a questionnaire. So questionnaire is an essential part of survey research. Questionnaire is not an essential part of, not an essential tool of data gathering in a qualitative method. But in a quantitative method, in a survey method, questionnaire is an essential tool. It is necessary. You cannot collect data using a survey method without using a questionnaire. But you can collect your data without using a questionnaire in one of the qualitative methods, whether you have done a focus group or a or a ethnography or a case study method. Data collection must be done in a neutral manner, and data analysis must be done without any bias. So these are important things to be kept in mind by the researcher if a researcher is using survey method for his or her own research. Sample. First step is sample and sampling. So what is sample? The survey method is largely criticized on this one ground. Sample. People will say, oh, you have used a survey method, your sample is small. Or people would say, oh, the sample is not representative. I'm not sure whom did you interview. Did you interview people? If I take the example again, which I took yesterday a couple of times about the farmers protest. And if I say, oh, farmers are very unhappy with, you know, the policies, the new farm laws. And you might ask me the question, how do you know that? I would say, I did a survey. I did a research. Which method? I said, I used a quantitative method. So did you have the data? No, I didn't have the data. I collected data on my own. So how did you collect the data? I collected the data using a survey. Where did you do the survey? And if I say, oh, I did the survey on the border areas where the kisans are sitting on a dharna. And you might say, but this is not an appropriate sample. Did you go to the villages? Did you go to the villages of UP, Bihar, Odisha, Bengal to collect the data from the farmers living in those areas? You have collected a wrong sample. Not only your sample is small because you collected data only from 100 farmers sitting on Sindhu border, Tikri border, and say Ghazipur border. Your sample is not only small, but your sample is not representative because you have left out farmers of Tamil Nadu, Kerala, and many states. You didn't go to the villages to speak to these farmers. So I can raise question mark about the findings of your survey, of your research. So sample is very important, and sample is referred to a small number of people selected from larger number of people, which more or less resembles the characteristics of larger population from which the sample is selected. So it is important in a survey that your sample should be representative. It should resemble more or less the characteristics of the larger population of which the study is being conducted. And remember now the example which I gave. It should resemble the characteristics of the larger population of which the study, about which the study is being done. If I say that I have done the study of farmers of India, and if I select the sample for my survey only amongst the farmers sitting on dharna on the four or five borders of Delhi, is this the will this be the representative sample of the farmers of India? I don't think this would be the representative sample of the farmers of India. I'm not sure whether all these farmers have come from different parts of the country or not. So for a good quality data to be collected by researcher using a survey method, it is important for the researcher to collect data, select the sample which is representative, which resembles the characteristics of larger population of the universe which you want to do the study. And in the example which I gave, the universe is farmers of India, not the farmers who are sitting on dharna. If the study was only about the level of satisfaction and dissatisfaction of the farmers sitting on dharna with the government, then this sample may have been appropriate if this was collected from, you know, random farmer sitting on dharna. But if I say this is the select sample of the farmers of India, and this is the voice of the farmers of India, selecting a sample only from the four borders among the farmers sitting on the dharna may not be a right sample. So one has to be very, very careful about sample, and this is the ground on which the survey method is mostly criticized. Now the question is, how big should be the sample? R bigger sample always better sample. R bigger sample always better compared to the smaller sample. And R bigger sample always better than smaller sample. So this is a question everybody keeps asking, that if I want to do a survey, I want to use survey as a method for my research, how much sample should I select for my survey? Whether it should be, and people generally have this notion, what percentage of the population should I select as the sample? Remember, when you are using survey method for doing research, as I said earlier also, survey is an important tool for doing research, for collecting data. If your universe of study, if your topic is such which is very large, which covers a very large area geographically and numerically, then survey is a better tool, more appropriate tool for data collection, for doing research. And if you are doing your research on a topic which is very large, possibly you can't think in terms of percentages, that I will be selecting X percentage of people for my sample. So sample should be guided by two things: sample size, unit of analysis, and size of universe. If the size of universe is very large, if I want to do the study of farmers of UP, this is a very large sample. UP is not small. Farmers of UP are in large numbers. I can't even think of selecting five. And people do research of various kind. I can do research of, you know, what do people of India think about, you know, the farmers. Generally, people of India thinks about the new farm laws, or farmers of India, or students of India, youths of India. It may not be possible for me to think of even selecting 1% of the sample, because the universe is very large. India has 140 crores people. If I think of selecting even 1%, it may not be possible for me to even select 1% of the population. So if the universe is very large, if the universe, the area of study on which the researcher want to do the study, that area is very, very large, you don't even think, the researcher should not even think in terms of percentages of population. You can only think in terms of exact numbers. You can think of number, but before thinking about the number, be clear what kind of analysis do you want to do based on the survey. If you have done a study in UP and if you want to do the analysis comparing various districts of UP, and if you want to compare all the 85 districts of UP, then you need to pick up a much bigger sample. But if you want to do the analysis only for UP as such, then you can pick up a smaller sample. Normally, if you select a sample of say 800, 900, 1000 people using a method, remember these are not 1000 people selected all over UP or 800 people selected all over UP without applying a method. It's about you apply a method, select about 1000 people, 800 people, that should be enough. That should be enough to give you information, to collect information which would be appropriate for doing an analysis. I know if you are a researcher based in a university, you would get puzzled that 1000 people, that's too big a sample. Yes, theoretically 800, 900 people, sample of 800, 900 people is good enough. But if you are a researcher and if you think there are lots and lots of constraint, I would suggest you can select smaller sample, maybe 250 to 300. But remember, don't use a survey method for your research, selecting only say 40, 50, 60, 70 people, not less than 200, 250 people. That should be the sample size. There are different methods of sample selection. As I said, I am stressing it again and again that it has to be, the data collection must involve some method, some technique. And even for selecting your sample, even for selecting the sample of say 800 people across UP or 500 people, 800 people across Meerut district or Moradabad district, if your study aims at looking at something in Muradabad or Meerut or Ghaziabad, any district or even in a village, the sample selection must be done using a method, sampling method. It cannot be done haphazardly. And these are the various sampling methods. Normally, we divide sampling methods into two types. Broadly, we divide sampling methods into two types. One is called probability method and the other is called non-probability method. Within probability method, as I mentioned yesterday, within qualitative method, there are different kinds of method. Similarly, within probability method of sample selection, there are different methods. Simple random method, systematic random method, multi-stage systematic random method, stratified random method. And within non-probability method, there are at least two types, mainly being used: convenience sampling, snowball sampling. But there are other methods as well. You might come across word like quota sampling and few other methods, but these are commonly used method of sampling in survey. If somebody is using survey method for doing research, for collecting data, these are the various methods of sample selection, and the researcher needs to think carefully. Like, he has to think carefully about selecting a research method, which method researcher should select for answering or investigating his research question. Similarly, if somebody has picked up survey method, if somebody has decided to use survey method for doing research, when the stage comes for sample selection, the researcher needs to think carefully about which method he or she should pick up for sample selection. Whether he should go for a simple random, systematic random, multi-stage systematic random, or stratified random, or if researcher want to use a non-probability sampling, again, it should not be guided by your choice, by your convenience. It should be guided by the nature of data and the process through which you may be able to collect the data which is required for answering your research question or investigating your research question. So these are the various methods of sampling. Generally, what is a probability technique? Probability sampling technique is a technique which ensures that the chances of being selected as the sample of each and every unit in the universe is more or less the same. So it is a probability sampling. Everybody has an equal chance. It's kind of a lottery. Roughly, in common sense, we can say it's a lottery. Everybody has an equal chance. All units will not be selected, because sample is always a subset of the universe, and the data in the survey is to be collected only from the sample. It is not required that the data should be collected from everyone. So everybody has an equal chance of being selected in the sample. That method is called probability sampling. And if in a non-probability sampling technique, chances of every element of the universe is not equal. Some group may have more chances and some people may have less chances of being selected in the sample. So suppose I want to do, I want to use a non, just to give you an example to explain, I'm teaching in a class and this is a classroom of 100 people, and I wanted to ask questions from few people in the class, and I use a probability technique and I can just say, okay, 7th person in the row, 9th person in the row, 12th person in the row, without, you know, just randomly. So that's a probability technique. Everybody has an equal chance. Nobody knows whose turn is going to come to answer the question. But if I say, no, in this classroom, now there are 100 students, I want to ask question, I want to pose a question to people sitting in the class, but let me tell you, I am not going to ask any question to the people who are sitting in the row 11th, 12th, 13th, 14th, 15th and beyond. I will only ask questions from the students sitting in row 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 up till 10. crude example of a non-probability technique of sampling, where I have ruled out all the people who are sitting in rows 11 or beyond to be selected in the sample. So this is kind of a non-probability technique of sampling. These are crude examples. Don't think that this technique works like the way I'm explaining. I'm explaining the way it may be possible to explain in this online setting. If this was a face-to-face classroom, I would have given you some work to do in the class, some practical sampling thing to be done to make it more clear. But I'm just using some crude example to explain what is a probability method of sampling and what is a non-probability method of sampling. I think I need to leave some time for you to ask questions, because if I go into the details of various sampling technique, you may not have any time to ask question. I can just flag off this sampling technique. Maybe we can think of some other class sometime only on sampling techniques, etc. But as I said, within the probability sampling technique, there is a technique called simple random sampling method, where the samples are selected simply randomly. Then we have a technique called systematic random sample. Again, the sample is selected randomly, but using some system. The interval is defined, so we know that at some interval it is, the sample is selected randomly, but this randomness also has some system built in. So that is systematic random sampling technique. We have multi-stage systematic random sample. The sample for data collection is selected systematically, but in various levels. It is applied for in case of universe being very large. If I want to select 1000 people across the country for my survey, I would apply multi-stage systematic random sample. And how does it work? It would work like, maybe at stage one I would select some states. I may not select all the states for my sample selection. Within states, I would select some district. So that would be stage two of sample selection. Within districts, I would select some locations. These locations could be urban locations. Some locations could also be the rural location. So that is multi-stage systematic random sample. Sample is being selected randomly using a system, but moving from, you know, the larger universe, moving down to smaller locations. So that is multi-stage systematic random sample. Convenient sampling technique falls within what we call non-probability technique, and this is simply the researcher selecting the sample as per convenience, not the best way of sample selection. If you use convenience for selecting the sample, you know what will happen. If you use convenience for anything as per my own convenience, this is not the best way of sample selection, because there has to be a method involved, and convenience does not involve any method. It only involves your convenience. So convenient sampling, snowball sampling, it is used for sample selection for the universe about which we have no idea in advance. So snowball, we keep selecting, interviewing people based on the reference which we get from the previous sample. So these are various technique of sample selection, and but once the sample is selected by the researcher, as I mentioned earlier, questionnaire is an integral part of any survey method. So a well-designed questionnaire is very important in survey method. A researcher must have a well-designed questionnaire in order to collect the data after the researcher has already selected the sample. So you do the sampling. After the sample is selected, a questionnaire is needed, a structured questionnaire, a well-designed structured questionnaire is needed. for data collection. Based on that questionnaire, the data is collected from the sample which is selected by the researcher. What are the basic principles of a well-designed questionnaire? How should it look like? Basic principles: neutral question, not biased question. It should be neutral, it should not be biased. Sensitive question to be designed very, very carefully. Generally, sensitive questions are very difficult to ask in a survey setting because you are asking questions generally one-to-one. While there could be various forms of data collection, you could also, you know, collect data online. But again, there are advantage and disadvantage of various modes of data collection. So sensitive question to be asked, designed very carefully. Sequence of questions, that also plays a very important role. Which question should be placed at the bottom, which question should be asked the first question. Sometimes we don't realize that we have placed a question which is the starting of the interview and it is a sensitive question. That is why it is important to test the questionnaire before you finally launch your full-fledged survey. I can give you an example. Suppose we are doing a survey and just an opening question. If we do a survey in Delhi and if I ask the opening question, the very first question, so how long you have been living in this city? I don't think this is maybe a very sensitive question in Delhi, but if you go to Assam and if you ask this question, how long you have been living in this in Assam or any locality where you're doing the survey, how long you have been living in this locality? You can imagine this question can become a sensitive question in Assam because of the prevailing situation, because of, you know, the register of citizens which is being prepared. So sequence of questions is also important. Where do you place, if you have to ask this sensitive question in Assam, where do you place this question? Should you begin your interview? Should this be the first question on your questionnaire or should it be somewhere else? So these consideration needs to be given while designing the questionnaire. These are some examples. I have already taken an example from Assam. And finally, how do you analyze the survey data and report the findings in the thesis? So if I recap, we did talk about yesterday about your research topic. Then we talked about research question. Then we talked about hypothesis. Today we had a discussion about research methods. We also talked about research methods yesterday. Today we had a discussion about how should the researcher think about selecting the research method, various strengths and weaknesses of various research methods. A great deal of time was spent on explaining quantitative method. Within the quantitative method, if somebody a researcher has decided to select a survey method, what caution should the researcher take while using survey method for data collection? I did explain about sampling. Sample is very important because that is the point on which survey data is largely criticized. So sample is very important. There are different methods of sample selection. Once the sample is selected, the data needs to be collected using a structured questionnaire. The basic principles of designing a good questionnaire is that questions should be designed in a neutral manner. It is also about question sequencing. So now we have the researcher imagine in an imaginary situation, the researcher has selected the sample, designed the questionnaire, collected the data now, and now it is the stage for doing the analysis of the data and now writing the report using the findings of the quantitative method, largely the survey data. So how should researcher use the findings from the survey data while writing chapters of his or her thesis? This is the topic on which I am going to speak tomorrow. We have 10-15 minutes for you to ask question. Thank you very much for your patience.